Good morning and welcome to Hope Evangelical Lutheran Church. I'm Pastor Tim Henning. Today we continue our message series, Our Living Faith, as we talk about offering our bodies as living sacrifices to God. God bless your worship today. And if you're watching us on our live stream and have any questions or comments, please contact us through our website and we'll get back to you as soon as possible. We begin now with the very first hymn, From All That Dwell Below the Skies. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We have come into the presence of God who created us to love and to serve him as his dear children, but we have disobeyed him and deserve only his wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to him and plead for his mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to his will.
Amen.
And now in the peace of the forgiveness that we have through Jesus Christ, let's join to praise the Lord. Let us pray. O Lord Jesus Christ, preserve the congregation of believers with your never-failing mercy. Help us avoid whatever is wicked and harmful, and guide us in the way that leads to our salvation. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated. Our first reading for today on the 15th Sunday after Pentecost is recorded in the prophet of Jeremiah chapter 15, beginning with verse 15. You know, Jeremiah understood how difficult it was to live for the Lord in a corrupt, twisted, and crooked generation of people living in Judah. In fact, he understood imprisonment for his proclamation and for his faith. But the Lord promised in times of persecution to deliver in his good time and according to his will. Let this word be ours as well, especially as we live in difficult times. Jeremiah wrote, O Lord, you understand. Remember me and care for me. Take vengeance for me on those who persecute me. You are slow to anger. Do not take me away. Keep in mind that for your sake I bear disgrace. Your words came to me and I devoured them. Your words became my joy, the delight of my heart, because I bear your name, O Lord God of armies. I did not sit with the band of partygoers, nor did I celebrate with them. I sat alone because your hand was upon me. You filled me with indignation. Why is my pain unending? Why is my wound incurable, refusing to heal? Will you be as deceptive as an intermittent stream to me, like a source of water that a person can't depend on? Therefore, this is what the Lord says. If you repent, I will take you back so that you may stand before me. If what you say is worthwhile and not worthless, you will be my spokesman. They must turn to you, but you must not turn to them. I will make you like a bronze wall to this people. They will fight against you, but they will not overcome you, because I am with you to save you and to rescue you, declares the Lord. I will rescue you from the hand of the wicked, and I will deliver you from the grasp of the ruthless. This is God's word. Please join with me as we read the psalm for today, Psalm 121. Today I ask you to read it in its entirety, including the refrain, with me, all in unison. Keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. Keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. This too is God's word. Please now arise out of respect for the gospel to hear the gospel for today. The Holy Gospel is recorded in the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 16, beginning with verse 21. As the time for Jesus' crucifixion grew closer and closer, Jesus became more and more specific about what was going to happen. We hear today Peter's reaction to that proclamation and also Jesus teaching us about how it's going to be for us. If we follow him, we must take up our cross and follow too. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he had to go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders, chief priests, and experts in the law, and be killed, and on the third day be raised again. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "May you receive mercy, Lord. This will never happen to you." But Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a snare to me because you are not thinking the things of God, but the things of men." Then Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone wants to follow me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. In fact, whoever wants to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. After all, what will it benefit a person if he gains the whole world but forfeits his soul? Or what can a person give in exchange for his soul?" This is the Holy Gospel. Please be seated and join with me in singing, "We All Are One in Mission." Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you always. Amen. I want to ask you a question. This is really important question for life, okay? How do you know the difference between a duck and all other birds? Well, that's easy for us, right? If it waddles like a duck, if it quacks like a duck, if it swims like a duck, and it looks like a duck, It's a duck. Now, I know you're giggling a little bit about that, but the real question I want to get to is, of course, the important one. How can we tell a person who claims to be a Christian is a Christian? How can we tell if a person on the inside is what you see on the outside? How can we tell if a person has a living faith? Well, you know, we can't absolutely ever know that, can we? Because we can't look at the heart. But Jesus does say, by their fruit you will know them. Today, as we continue our message series about our living faith, we want to see that our living faith offers living sacrifices to God. We turn our attention today to the letter of St. Paul to the Romans, chapter 12. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, by the mercy of God, to offer your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God, which is your appropriate worship. Also, do not continue to conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, so that you test and approve what is the will of God, what is good, pleasing, and perfect. So by the grace given to me, I tell everyone among you not to think of yourself more highly than you ought, but think in a way that results in sound judgment, as God distributed a measure of faith to each of you. For we have many members in one body, and not all the members have the same function. In the same way, though we are many, we are one body in Christ and individual members of one another. We have different gifts according to the grace God has given us. If the gift is prophecy, do it in complete agreement with the faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is encouraging, then encourage. If it's contributing, be generous. If it's leadership, be diligent. If it is showing mercy, do it cheerfully. This is God's word. Our living faith offers living sacrifices to God. And Paul says you do that by offering your bodies to God. Now let's begin where Paul begins here. He speaks about fellow believers when he wrote, "Therefore I urge you, brothers, by the mercy of God." Now you perhaps understand this, that in Scripture, when the word brothers is used in this kind of context, and it is many times, it is not gender related at all. He's talking about the brotherhood of believers. He's talking to all of us who are one in Christ. There's no difference between male and female, for instance, as Paul writes the Galatians. What he does emphasize by using this is that you and I are children of God. We're in a family of believers. And how do we get in that family of believers? How is it that we become close to God and close to each other? He says it right there. He says, by the mercies of God. God's mercies are his unfailing love. Has God ever failed to distribute his love to you or to the world? Not only has he given us life for now, but by God's grace, because of his mercy for us, he has made us his children through faith in Christ Jesus. He, in his love, brought us into this body of Christ, the family of God. And so we are brothers and sisters together, children of God. Paul speaks to fellow believers when he offers up to us two different encouragements. The first encouragement: therefore, I urge you, brothers, by the mercy of God, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God, which is your appropriate worship. You get that word up there, I urge you? That's a pretty powerful word. It's not like I hope you do it. I want you to do it. Could you possibly do it? He's saying, I urge you. This is a push forward, isn't it? As the apostle who speaks under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he's pushing God's family forward. to offer themselves as sacrifices to God. Paul strongly urges them to, see, there's the word there, the purpose, to offer your bodies. Now, when God called you and me to faith in Jesus Christ, he didn't just call us to faith with our souls, did he? He called us to faith, all of us, body and soul. He redeemed us all, not just our souls, but our bodies and souls. That's why the body is important in the resurrection. But that's for another sermon. He wants us to offer up ourselves. We can't see the offering up of faith in a person's soul, can we? We can't see that. But what can we see? What comes from the heart through the hands. What comes out of the heart through the mouth. You see Paul's point here? We as people who have a living faith will daily offer ourselves up completely to God. Sacrifice is something that is a complete thing. Remember the whole burnt offerings of the Old Testament? Now, I know that pointed ahead to Christ's offering on the cross, but that's something we do as his people, as his children. It's not just parts of us. It's not just here and there. It's just not today and not tomorrow. We offer ourselves up in thanksgiving to our God as a living sacrifice, wholly dedicated to our God. And when we do that, the fruits of faith are going to show up. By their fruits, you will know them, Jesus said. Now, when we think about us offering up something to God, ourselves to God, that's something that we can't do fully or completely, can we? That's a fight that we have because of our sinful natures. But it's something that Christ did fully. Did he not? See, Jesus just didn't offer up parts of his life for us. He gave up 33 years of his life for us, living perfectly under the law, so that when we stand before God on Judgment Day, he's going to see Jesus' perfect life and not my sins, not your sins. Isn't that a cool thing? Because you can't get into heaven unless you're perfect. And I haven't been around too many perfect people lately, especially myself. But what's more, he offered up a sacrifice on top of his whole life. And you know that very well, right? On the cross, the altar of the cross, he offered up himself as the sacrifice for sin, and not only ours, but for the sins of the whole world. He became a complete, a whole sacrifice in our place. Wow. And here's the real important truth on top of that one. God did not leave his son in the grave. Jesus arose from the dead, so that by his resurrection, you have, and I have, and all believers in Christ have, Jesus' perfect life as our robes of righteousness, and our sins have been washed away by his perfect blood. We stand before God not guilty. I urge you, in view of that mercy of God, to offer up yourselves totally and completely. That's his first encouragement. Now we come to the second encouragement of Paul, verse 2. And also, do not conform. And he uses the word continue because the Greek word is an ongoing thing there. Do not continue to conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind so that you test and approve what is the will of God, what is good, pleasing, and perfect. We know the pattern of this world. Unfortunately, we know it all too well. I'm just going to give you an example, and this is not a political thing, but I'm going to take the example of all these political commercials right now. What do they aim to do? The Eighth Commandment is violated every single time one of those comes up, and it's tearing somebody else's reputation down. That is sin. Sometimes people do that because they want to feel better about their own lives, so they tear somebody else down. Look at the bad stuff. You see it every day. And unfortunately, we see it right inside our own sinful nature sometimes too, don't we? Where instead of offering up ourselves completely to our God to do His good and pleasing and perfect will, things come out of our hands as we slap somebody. Things come out of our mouths that should never be said. That gives the impression that we're conforming to the pattern of this world. God forgive us. No excuse for that. We're supposed to offer up our bodies as living sacrifices. That's why sometimes our behavior confuses unbelievers. You see, they see us and we're supposed to be different and we look just like the world. But that's why Jesus came in the first place, isn't it? To forgive those sins and then to give us the strength so that we, with a renewal of our minds, might be able to offer up our bodies as living sacrifices to God. The renewal of our minds. How does that happen? How is it made new and fresh time and time again? You know the answer. The Holy Spirit works through word and sacrament. By attending the Lord's Supper regularly, we are being renewed in our minds. Because what's in the inside comes to the outside, from the inside out. And we turn to God's Word on Sundays, yes, all throughout the week in our private readings and devotions. And God is renewing our minds so that we see who God is. And so we use the law which crushes us in our sin. And the gospel, which reminds us time and again that Jesus Christ lived, died, and rose for us. Brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus, if we're going to offer up our bodies as living sacrifices, we need to take this urging by the Apostle Paul and get our minds renewed, because then we won't conform to the pattern of this world, no matter what that is. And so when we heed Paul's, or rather the Lord's, urging and encouragement, then we will be humbly able to use the gifts God gives us. Anything before that, we get the wrong reasons for serving our God. The fruit might look good on the outside, but on the inside it's all rotten. We want to serve our God with a proper attitude of faith. Again, this comes from understanding from the law our great need and from the gospel how that need was fulfilled in our Lord Jesus Christ. If we don't start there, we can't have a proper attitude. Then we'll be doing it for all the wrong reasons. So people pat you on the back, hey, that was a great offering this week. Man, I'm sure glad you served on the council or did whatever. It's not about me, and it's not about you either. What's it about? It's about our Lord Jesus Christ, isn't it? That's our appropriate worship, as Paul said earlier. As our Savior, Jesus did everything because of God's great love for us. When we recognize just how terrible we are and how great our need is before God, until we're brought down into the dust, our faces in the dirt and mud before our God, we can't understand the great privilege we have, and we will never have the right attitude of service. That's biblical. My sinful nature fights that. But that's what the Bible says about our attitudes. Paul says, by the grace given to me, I tell everyone among you not to think of yourself more highly than you ought, but think in a way that results in sound judgment as God distributed a measure of faith to each of you. Sound judgment only comes out of a living faith, as we're put through the ringer of life, so to speak. As we go through difficulties and trials and sometimes crises, the Lord builds us to trust in Him more. And our attitude becomes more godly. It's an ongoing process. It'll never be perfected this side of our deaths. In writing to the Philippians, Paul talks about this too. Remember this? Do nothing out of selfish ambition or empty conceit, but in humility consider one another better than yourselves. Indeed, let this attitude be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. The perfect Creator, Son of God, takes on human flesh and humbles himself and becomes obedient to death on the cross for, put your name in there, but not only for you, for all people, correct? On top of that measure of faith that he's given to each of us, he's also given a growing faith through his word and sacraments. Our attitudes will reflect what's in the heart as much as our fruits will. Our attitude is one of thanksgiving. It's about humility. And so with the proper management, that proper thing, we can properly manage God's gifts given to us. Now, Paul uses the picture of the human body to talk about the body of Christ. And we know from other scriptures that the head of this body is Christ himself. And in our heads, we have all of the things that direct the rest of our body, right? I mean, you wouldn't feel pain from dropping an anvil on your toe if your brain wasn't working right to tell you, ouch, right? It's where the seat of our emotions are. It's where the movements come. It's where back here in the brainstem, all your vitals are going on, correct? For the church to operate, we need Christ as our head. And we are all members of that body of Christ, as Paul says, for we have many members in one body, and not all the members have the same function. My function in this part of the body of Christ is a whole lot different than everybody else's here, right? Doesn't make me better or worse, just different. And how did I get to this function? God gifted me with the things I needed to accomplish this. Do I have all the gifts that you want a pastor to have? No. Do you have all the gifts God's given to his church? No. But you have the ones that God gave you so that you in the body of Christ can serve. In the same way, though we are many, we are one body in Christ and individually members of each other. We can't accomplish God's purpose alone. Did you catch that? It takes all of us working together with the right attitude based on the love of Jesus Christ, the mercies of our God, to carry out what God has put us in the world to do, which is real simple, right? We talked about that last week, profess Christ. We call that the Great Commission. And so God gives us different gifts in different volumes. We have different gifts according to the grace God has given us. That's why we don't look down on somebody else's service because it's different than mine or seems less significant. Not true. In the body of Christ, everything's significant. How important is your big toe? Well, without your big toes, you can't balance very well and you can't run. Did you know that? Seems kind of an insignificant part of the body. Pretty important, isn't it? Oh, we can probably function without it, but not very well. Same thing in the body of Christ. God has given different gifts according to his grace. If the gift is prophecy, do it with complete agreement to the faith. Here it's not faith as what's in us, it's the faith. It's the embodiment of the Christian faith. If it's serving, then serve. If it's teaching, then teach. Kind of important as we start up our classes today after the second service. So hopefully you might be able to get back for that Bible class in here. If it's encouraging, then encourage. If it's contributing, do it generously. If it's leadership, be diligent. If it is showing mercy, do it cheerfully. Now, Paul talks about this also in Corinthians and in Ephesians. St. Peter talks about this in his epistle. It's not an exhaustive list. And it doesn't even begin to talk about the physical abilities we have, the abilities and gifts for this age, for our time in this world, temporal gifts. But God has showered us with all those things so that together we can offer up our body, the body of Christ, as a living sacrifice to God in our service. You get what Paul's talking about to us today? How do you know that this person has a living faith? How do you know that a group of Christians have a living faith? Well, if it walks like a believer, and it talks like a believer, and serves like a believer, it's a believer. Outside of the hypocrite. Of course, like I said, we can't be absolute. But that's what the Bible's teaching us today. Our living faith shows up in our offering of a living sacrifice to God. And finally, Paul says, that's your appropriate worship. It's the appropriate way to give glory to God, to speak well about God. It's not just by what we say. It's not just by the hymns we sing or the prayers we offer. It's by a full life fueled by the gospel of Jesus Christ, understanding that it's the grace of God, it's a free gift because we can't do it ourselves. And we humbly serve with thanksgiving for all that our God has done for us in the time he's allotted to us in this world. Not belittling other gifts, not raising others up as more important, but together, so that we can make disciples of all nations using the means of grace, baptism, and the word. And that we will continue to do. That's our commitment to Christ. I wish I could tell you that I've done this perfectly over the last 4 decades, you know. But this is where the Lord reminds me of my great need. I need the cross. I need the resurrection, or I can't move forward in my life to serve my God. And the same is, I think, true for all of you, for those sitting here, for those watching. It's true for everyone in our world today. Our world is so fragmented and polarized today that it's just a remarkable thing how quickly that's happened. Where you have violence in the streets, sheriff deputies being ambushed, places broken into under the guise, well, I have a right, people's lives being destroyed. Then you add to it God's will, where you see fires happening all over the place. We even get the dust here, the ashes here the last few days. You couldn't see the sun clearly. And then you see that even with those calls of God to repent, that the world goes on living not according to the faith, but for what their sinful natures are saying. We live in a twisted and crooked generation. There is only one antidote to this, and that's to let our living faith show up as we offer up ourselves as living sacrifices to God, as we proclaim the gospel and pray that the Holy Spirit might rescue some, as he in his love rescued us. Live your faith. Please join with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we continue to live in this world filled with sin and sinners, as we recognize our failures and our weaknesses, we pray first of all that you would remind us day after day of your great mercy and love in Jesus, that you forgive us for his sake. Then arm us with the gospel and with the gifts of the Spirit and with all the other gifts that we need to carry your gospel message by living our faith as we offer up our lives and our bodies as living sacrifices to you. Grant that these might bring blessings to others. In Jesus' name, amen. Please arise now and join with me as we confess the Christian faith. This morning, we use the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And please join with me in prayer. O Lord God, we thank you for the wondrous gift of Jesus Christ, your Son, and for the promised graces we have received through him. We thank you that through his perfect life and his obedience to death on the cross, we have been granted cleansing and pardon for all our sins. We thank you that in his resurrection, we have the promise of life everlasting, and that in his ascension to the right hand of your majesty, we have the assurance that he continually intercedes for us, cares for us, and protects us. Help us believe and trust in him, love and serve him, that in all our thoughts, words, and actions, we may manifest his Spirit as we offer up our bodies as living sacrifices to you. Rebuke our selfishness and subdue our self-indulgence. Deepen our sympathies, strengthen our hope, and confirm us in our faith. Dwell in our homes, O Lord, and let the trust of our families be centered in you alone, so that no difficulty, trial, or adversity may rob us of the conviction that you are our only helper in every time of need. Relieve the afflictions of the weary and the sick. Dry the tears of the troubled, the sorrowful, and the mourning. Lead them all to look to you as the unfailing spring of healing and hope. Lord, now hear us as you promised, as we bring to you our private petitions and prayers. All these things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior and Lord, who taught us to pray, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now receive with believing hearts the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Please be seated now as we listen to our seminary sing, Lord, when your glory I shall see. Please join in the words.
Lord, when your glory I shall see, I shall see. Thank you.
thanks for worshiping with us this morning, and we pray that God would go with you this week as you live your living faith, offering up yourselves to God for the sake of others. God bless you and have a great week.